Okay. Assalamu alaikum, everyone who's joined the latest Google Hangout sponsored by Muslim Wellness Foundation. And my name is Camilla Rashad. I'm the founder of Muslim Wellness Foundation. And this is an organization which seeks to reduce stigma related to mental illness, addiction, and trauma in the American Muslim community through dialogue, education, and training. So the Healers Collective Forum actually was born out of really an urgent need to connect Muslim mental health professionals following the tragedy of the Chapel Hill shootings. We really felt strongly that this was kind of a moment, not just in North Carolina, but across the country, where Muslim mental health professionals wanted to be connected to really talk about how we respond appropriately and effectively and competently to the needs of the community. So the Hangout is actually open to everyone, not just professionals, because we as professionals also want to work with community members and be transparent about our process, as well as invite religious leaders, faith leaders, advisors, to also kind of understand the conversations that Muslim mental health professionals have on a, from a clinical angle, but also, again, it's about transparency, and so that people can kind of get an understanding of our thought process and how we also connect as a community of professionals. So alhamdulillah, I have three amazing professionals who have agreed to join this this month's May's Google Hangout, the Healers Collective Forum. And the topic is understanding Islamic psychology. And alhamdulillah, I think in probably less than 48 hours, we had such an enthusiastic response to this topic and some of the subjects that we're going to cover that it really, you know, I was overjoyed just by how enthusiastically everyone who's watching, who, you know, commented and provided feedback, that this is something definitely that resonates with the community. It speaks to our desire to kind of integrate spirituality with an understanding of who we are. So I'm just going to do a quick overview of each of the panelists. They will have 15 minutes each to give their presentation, their understanding of Islamic psychology, how they've used it in their own clinical practice. And we also will have opportunity to open it up to the viewers to ask questions. So on the Google Plus page or on the YouTube page, feel free to submit your comments or suggestions, questions for the panelists, and I will be able to read those. And, you know, inshallah, perhaps we can have those questions answered live on air. So our first panelist is Sister Marwa Assar. She is currently the doctoral clinical intern at Pharaon Consulting Group. Marwa received her master's degree in counseling psychology from Rutgers University, and she is currently a doctoral candidate in clinical psychology at the Chicago School of Professional Psychology. She has completed all her doctoral coursework, congratulations, and finishing up and in completing her last year of internship. Marwa's passion for many years focused on formulating an Islamic approach to understanding psychology and how to apply Western psychology concepts within an Islamic context. So welcome, Sister Marwa, to the Hangout. our second panelist is Brother Ibrahim Long. He's a professionally trained chaplain with experience serving in healthcare, educational, and correctional institutions. He presently serves as a youth counselor and Islamic studies teacher at Edmonton Islamic Academy in Canada. We won't hold your Canadian residency against you. alhamdulillah. He has written a chapter called Caring for the Muslim Soul, Approaches to the Spiritual Care of Muslim Patients, recently published in a book titled Psychotherapy, Cure for the Soul. In addition to his academic education and professional training, Ibrahim studies Islamic law, theology, and spirituality with a variety of traditionally trained Muslim scholars. He received his bachelor's in humanities and religious studies from California State University, where he focused on the history and theology of the Abrahamic faiths. So He also has a master's in Islamic studies and Christian-Muslim relations and a graduate certificate in Islamic chaplaincy from Hartford Seminary. So welcome and assalamu alaikum to you, Brother Ibrahim. And last but certainly not least, Brother Karim Serageldin, please tell me if I'm not pronouncing your name correctly.
Serageldin, but that's very close, yes.
It wasn't close at all. You're being very kind. Serageldin. He's the founder of Noor Psychology, a dedicated practice serving Muslims in America through counseling and education programs. The vision of his practice is to provide services that integrate cultural sensitivity, science, spirituality, and psychology. His years of educational instruction brings a powerful element of learning to his helping methods, where he specializes in premarital assessments, men's issues, youth, marriage, and family counseling. He has a master's in psychology and spiritual counseling, and also he's a certified professional life coach, certified in premarital counseling, and has years of educational and teaching experience. So alhamdulillah, welcome to you as well, Brother Karim. So as you can see, we have, alhamdulillah, an expert panel. I couldn't think of anyone, from the background and experiences that you all bring, from chaplaincy, from a doctoral perspective, from life coach and marriage and family education, alhamdulillah, I thought this was a really dynamic panel. So I thank you all again for agreeing to participate. Before we begin with the presentations and the discussion, I wanted to ask Brother Ibrahim if you could begin our discussion with dua.
Of course. Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salam ala rasulillah. All praises belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and peace and blessings be upon the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the one who has inspired so many to care for others as we are caring for others, and those who are here listening to us are also caring for others as well. O Allah, may bless our words and bless this event and bless this gathering. Bless this to be a gathering of light and a gathering of hearts and a gathering of knowledge that we could take from it fruit, that we could put into practice and put into our lives. May Allah bless all those who have brought this together, our sisters and our brothers who are here tonight. And may Allah Ta'ala guide us all as we walk away, inshallah, with something good to share with our communities. Amen.
Okay, and with that, Sister Marwa will begin with her presentation, which provides, inshallah, a nice overview of Islamic psychology, different principles and concepts, so kind of a foundational overview of this important subject. Sister Marwa?
Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Inshallah, today I'm going to talk about the psychological system that exists within us and how we can approach and understand that system within an Islamic lens. And so it's really important to understand that it's really important to understand that, when we study Islamic teachings, that there's a constant psychological dialogue that's incorporated in the literature that allows us to understand the nature of the human being. And so the deen, our deen and our religion is designed towards the nature of a human being. And Islam's teachings are created to address and satisfy those needs. So when we study Islamic teachings, we see that they promote our spiritual facets, but they don't, they don't disregard our biological and psychological components as well. And so what fascinated me always about studying Islamic psychology was that, I always was intrigued by how much Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has equipped us with, all the tools that we need to really live life, with peace and with harmony and just have a level of stability. And in addition, I saw constantly how so much research effort was being put into you know, divulging into Eastern philosophies and religions and deriving a more holistic approach. And very little efforts were being put into understanding what Islam has to offer into for the world of psychology. Even though we have so many, you know, scholars, early scholars like, you know, Al-Ghazali, Al-Kindi, Al-Razi, Ibn Sina, you know, all these scholars that contributed to the understanding of psychology, that even promoted the understanding of psychology into the Renaissance period. And so it's, you know, this understanding of psychology is not strange to our deen. It's fully, our deen is fully packed with a lot of the psychological tools and knowledge. And so whenever we try to understand any system, really, there's two main questions that we always have to ask, which is, what are the entities that make up this system? So what exists within this system? And two, how should these entities interact with each other for the system to function effectively? So our world is full of many systems, and you know, whether it's the solar system, the ecosystem, even within our body, there's the respiratory system, the digestive system, right? Each system not only has its entities, but it also has a unique orbit, a unique flow. And like if we look at the solar system, for example, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us signs of this orbit in many, in a variety of ways, but if we specifically look at the solar system, we'll see that, you know, the planets revolve around the sun, right? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala designed the sun to be the only entity, right, with the strongest gravitational pull to keep the planets in that orbit around it. And if the planets revolved around anything else, there would be chaos and there would be disruption. And this is the same case with any of the other systems. There's a certain flow. And when these entities are not in the designed flow, there's always a level of distress. And so first step is to, the first question was, what are the entities, right? And so quickly, you know, we have the physical body. We have ar-ruh, which we know to be our soul, our spirit. The qalb, which is our inner spiritual heart. This is the main tool that we utilize to connect to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then, you know, its purpose is to seek God, and that's the way it was designed. And then we have our nafs. This is the part of ourselves that, this is the pleasure and desire seeking part of ourselves. This is the part of ourselves that contains the lower drives. And then we have our aql, which is the intellect and cognition. And if you notice here, I didn't say brain, right? Because Islamic psychology actually understands aql to be not confined to just one organ, not the brain. It actually, the concept of cognition and intellect from an Islamic perspective is not just confined to the brain. It actually is also within the heart. So both our brain and heart have the ability to process and understand information in their own way. And we see this constantly in the Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sometimes, he refers, when he talks about contemplation and reflection, understanding, he sometimes refers to the brain, but other times he refers to our heart. And if we see here from these three ayat, we'll see that there's an association between our heart and the ability to reason, our heart and the ability to understand, our heart and the ability to contemplate and reflect. And, you know, this is a constant reminder that, you know, the intellect, the ability of intellect and cognition is not just limited to our mind. And, you know, I find that the understanding of the psychological system is really beneficial for clients, because you can't know how to navigate your way without knowing your design, you know, without knowing what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put within you and the tools He gave you within you to navigate your way. So understanding, you know, that we have this nafs, this ego-containing self, right, this desire-seeking part of ourselves, often referred to as a child within us. You know, a child throws a temper tantrum when they don't get their way, right? And we do this as adults in different ways. We can get angry. We have all these different reactions, you know, when the ego doesn't get its comfort, right, when the nafs doesn't get what it wants. We have our brain. The brain is, it's constantly interacting with the environment through our senses, right? Our senses are the first mode of interaction with the environment. It's constantly collecting information through our hearing and through our sight. And the brain is constantly collecting that information and processing it. And this understanding, you know, is empowering, because it shows us, you know, that we have a choice in what we expose our senses to, that it's a personal trust that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us. And so, you know, there's the power of, there's a process also of reflection and perception that our brain has the ability to do. And then we have the heart, the qalb, which seeks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, has the ability to decipher truths and meanings from life circumstances. And the state of our soul and ruh is a reflection of the state of our heart and its level of connection to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And, you know, laying out these entities within us helps us understand the role that each of them play in our lives. It helps a client understand the role they play in regulating these components within themselves. A lot of times there's a level of distress, but we don't know what is it. You know, is it a heart issue? Is it my nafs? Is it, you know, what am I exposing myself to? You know, like as far as my hearing, my sight, you know, what am I collecting? What is the information that I'm collecting essentially? And so, these are the entities, and we answered the first question. And the second question is, what is the design flow? And when I refer to the solar system, I talked about how the sun was the center of that flow. From an Islamic psychological perspective, the heart is the king of this system. And every other component in the system is there to serve the heart. And the heart, because the heart is essentially the strongest and main tool within us that's designed to connect with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and fulfill our purpose. And the key here is that when the heart is connected to its source, there's an unveiling that happens. That, you know, the closer you get to Allah, Allah continues to lift veils and veils from your heart, allowing you to perceive meanings and further understanding from our life circumstances that sometimes our brain is limited and cannot do that. And so if we look at this picture here, we see that the ego is taking up pretty much a big portion of the picture, and so is the brain. And we see the heart is pretty much subservient to the ego and the brain. And the brain looks oppressive, it's carrying a stick, and it's, you know, abusing the heart. And unfortunately, this is actually a reflection of what our system looks like when it's in a level of distress, right? And this is the Islamic psychological perspective, is that there's a certain alignment that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala designed our system to be aligned a certain way. And that, you know, and this dialogue is a little strange to Western thought because, you know, we idolize the mind in our culture. We idolize this idea of intelligence. You know, we think that the mind should have all the answers. And the mind, we have, you know, you see little cartoons where, you know, the brain is like yelling, similar to this one actually, where the brain is telling the heart, I told you better, right? I told you so, and that, you know, that the brain knew better. And so, you know, we're changing the dialogue here, and the dialogue here saying that no, there's this part within us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created that's actually, you know, very strong and has the ability to decipher meanings, that it's not just the brain that can do that. And I'll explain later why introducing this concept has a direct effect on a person's understanding of their struggles as well. And so this idea or this concept that the heart is the king, there are signs that reflect the reality of our heart's position within our deen. For example, when we look at sujood, right, we put our forehead to the ground. And in that forehead area, you know, that's the part of our brain, it's called the frontal lobe. And that part of our brain is the part that is responsible for high executive functioning. That's the part of our brain that differentiates us from animals. And yet, in this most noble and truest positions, right, where we are closest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in this alignment, we can see that the heart is higher than our brain, right? And so there's a sign in that, you know, showing us where the position of where our heart really stands. Also, another a great example is in Ramadan. You know, in Ramadan, we gain a sense of stability. We gain a sense of, you know, harmony that we get just from where everything is aligned in Ramadan. I mean, in Ramadan, we're depriving our nafs, so the nafs is weaker. Our egos are weaker because we're more conscious of what we're saying. We're more conscious of, you know, if we're fueling our nafs or our heart. And at the same time, we're more conscious of what we expose our senses to, of what we say, of what we look at, what we hear. And this fuels our brain with positive knowledge and the remembrance of Allah. And, you know, and that in itself is serving the heart during this month. And so when the nafs is being deprived and the brain is being utilized to serve the heart, then, you know, the heart steps up to the front lines, and then we experience the stability and, like, the sense of the level of harmony when things within our psychological system are aligned the way that they should be. And so in therapy, you're explaining that the you're essentially explaining the concept that the heart is the king, not the brain, right? And, you know, this concept brings to the client's awareness of the burden that we put on our mind to figure out everything. And there's an exhaustion and a burdensome weight when we are living as if the mind is the king. And, you know, we go through situations in life where, you know, we process, like say we have a problem, right? We process, our brain processes all the information that's in front of us, and sometimes our brain comes back and with a solution, right? We have a solution to the problem. So, okay, 1 + 1 = 2, right? But there are times when, you know, our brain processes all the information that's in front of us and then comes back with no answer. So we tell our brain, think again, you know, calculate again, process again. And it comes back with nothing. And so when we're only on a mental level, right, then, you know, we put this burden on our brain constantly to think again, and we obsess over that, you know. And so, existential psychology, which is very in line with, it has a lot of common ground with Islamic psychology, it says that suffering occurs when we're unable to derive meaning from our pain. And, you know, there's an understanding that pain and suffering are two different things. You know, there's a saying that pain is inevitable, suffering is optional. You know, pain is always going to happen. Staying only on a mental level without allowing our heart to gain strength and take the lead, our mind will always fall short in deriving meaning from our difficult experiences. And, you know, I had a client ask me, you know, how can there be any meaning from bad experiences? I mean, bad experiences are bad experiences. But this was a client that I had, and this was a very rewarding experience for me to see how important it is to explain these concepts. Because, you know, to explain to her that she was, you know, to allow her to facilitate a process where she can see that she's only on the mental level, right? That there was a disconnect there from the mind and the heart. And that, you know, there's a lack of confusion about this, all the entities that are within us. I mean, there's a level of confusion about the entities that exist within us. And so when you're only on the mental, when everything is, you're dependent on the mind, you know, to figure out everything, you know, there's a level of burden that we experience. And so it's really important to explain this concept and to allow them to understand that there are tools within them that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has equipped them with that are empowering, that have the ability to, you know, that when connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that have the ability to, you know, derive meaning and understanding in a different way of their experience. And, you know, we know the ayah in the Quran, innama al-usri yusra, with hardship comes ease, you know. It's not necessarily that after hardship comes ease, it's that through the hardship there is ease, there is meaning, there is understanding that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestows upon us. And so it's really important to identify these entities, because you can't communicate something clearly unless you can identify it. And helping a client recognize these entities within themselves aids them in increasing their self-awareness. And so many times we'll say things about ourselves when we don't really know which part of ourselves is communicating that idea. So, you know, a lot of times we'll say, like, I want this or that, or I like this or that, or I hate this or that, right? But which part of us hates that thing? Which part of us likes that thing? Is it our heart that seeks Allah that hates that thing? Or is it our nafs, our desire-seeking self that's saying that? Is it our ego? You know, so differentiating between these things allows for a dialogue to exist where a person understands these entities within themselves and just a heightened sense of self and a heightened sense of understanding of their needs and their wants. And being able to identify these entities helps them communicate it further. So, and then in order for, so we said the mind is there to serve the heart, right? But there is a crucial factor that needs to take place in order for the heart to be served by the mind, and that's the mind needs to be present. They say depression is often associated with our mind being consumed by the past, and anxiety often associated with our mind being consumed by the future. And so if our mind is in the past, and in the future, it's not in the present. And that's where our heart needs it to be in order to be fueled. So the heart gets malnourished when the mind is off somewhere else in the future and the past, or in the past. And, you know, understanding this importance of being present is really important to activate, for the activation of the heart. And, you know, this concept relates a lot to mindfulness therapy, which isn't a surprise because a lot of mindfulness therapy concepts are based of, you know, they reference Rumi's teachings a lot. And, you know, if you study Rumi's teachings, a lot of it is very centered around the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the love of the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And, you know, in mindfulness therapy, you're teaching the client to play the role of the witness, being in control of their thoughts, emotions that come in and out of even moments of our day. You know, we're constantly thinking, and we're constantly having thoughts and we're having emotions. And, you know, when you are present and when you play this role of the witness, you know, and you realize that the mind is not the king, you don't give power to every thought you have, right? You don't halt to every emotion that you have. And, of course, this is something that, you know, it's a process that has to be learned, that takes, it's not something that comes easy. But, you know, getting the client to understand the role of the mind, you know, it allows them to see that not every thought I have, you know, is true. You know, not every thought that I have, you know, it means that it's necessarily a reflection of my state. Just because I think that something bad is going to happen, it's not a reflection of my reality. But this can only happen when we understand that the mind is not the king. But if we idolize the mind and we idolize the brain as the know-it-all of everything, right, as the, you know, the highest functioning, you know, the you know, the crutch that we depend on all the time, you know, to figure out everything, then this idea is not going to be understood clearly. But when we understand that, you know, the mind is there to serve a function and it's there to process and understand the world, but to serve the heart essentially, then we can get, you know, we can allow for a conversation to take place where we can see things for what they really are. And, you know, the past and the future, they're illusions, you know, and current illusions. So when the only reality that exists is really the present, right? And to help them stay in that reality is a constant effort that a therapist would take with a client in helping them, you know, strive towards being present with their mind and allowing their mind to feed their heart. An example of this, you know, I had a client who, you know, had a lot of struggle when it comes to prayer. And so, you know, every time they'd really long to pray, but when they get to prayer, you know, their mind just consumed their thoughts and their thoughts consumed the entire prayer. And, you know, a lot of times when we talk about this, we often attribute that struggle to shaitan, and we say it's because of shaitan. And although shaitan's presence is there, of course, but, you know, there is a personal responsibility you need to take as well. And so it empowers, this dialogue empowers the role to go to prayer with your heart, right? And not with all of these thoughts and your mind. And so, you know, a lot of times we dismiss that struggle right away. We say just because of shaitan, but there's a role that we play too, and it's because we put so much emphasis on the mind. So, like, you know, I remember with this client, we talk about how, you know, initially their heart wants to pray, right? Their heart is longing for prayer, and then they get to prayer. And, you know, their heart is trying to be present, but what does the mind do? You know, you didn't say that fatha very well. You know, you didn't say it again, or, you know, of course, a lot of this could be shaitan, but there's also a level when we don't train our mind, when we let our thoughts take control of us and not the opposite, and we don't learn that practice, it can be very easy for our mind to also be the king of that prayer. Not our heart can lack that connection during prayer and not receive that connection during prayer. So getting the client to stay present is difficult initially, but it's very possible. It's just strange for them, but it's like, you know, it's like working out a muscle that you never worked out before. You know, it's not something that will come easy initially, but I found that understanding these psychological concepts and understanding the way these entities work within us helps a lot. In prayer, helps a lot in being present, being more present in our lives, and just to take a more active and take more personal responsibility in our lives. And so, you know, I'll end with this, where the Rasulullah says, there lies within the body a piece of flesh, and if it is sound, the whole body is sound, and if it's corrupted, the whole body is corrupted. Barely this piece is the heart. And so there is a constant emphasis on our heart and its condition being reflective of the condition of our entire being. And so, and finally, educating the mind without educating the heart is no education at all. Jazakumallah khair.
Well, thank you so much, Sister Marwa, for that really just wonderful presentation. And I was, you know, jotting down notes and trying to, you know, really just kind of remember some of the things that you know, kind of wove throughout your presentation. And, you know, I think that comes in the form of one thing you said: the heart is not nourished when the mind is off in the past or in the future. And so we can talk a little bit about this later, perhaps, you know, when we kind of have a more open discussion. But I think it's also kind of related to this idea about in more Western kind of culture, valuing logic and being very rational as something that's, you know, kind of associated with the mind. And so, you know, kind of speaking from your heart and being, you know, quote unquote emotional is something that's seen as weak. It's something that's very feminine, like women kind of speak from the heart and are emotional, whereas, you know, being rational and logical and pragmatic is something that is associated with men, and that is more highly valued. And so I think, you know, it's fascinating to me that embedded in our tradition is this idea that, you know, the heart is where, you know, we should be concentrating, you know, most of our energy and our efforts, because if your heart is corrupted, then, you know, having a rational mind is not going to help you be as effective as possible. So again, you know, just talk about for that, just, you know, great presentation, and I'm sure there are questions that are coming up, but I want to offer Brother Ibrahim the time to present also your perspective, and then we can also share. So I'm going to turn it over to you.
Okay, inshallah, and I'll share screen. Is everyone able to see my screen? Assalamu alaikum. Is everyone able to see my screen?
Oh, I don't think you can hear us. Yes, we were able to see it.
Yeah? Okay. Thank you. So can you see it now?
No, we see you now.
All right, give me a sec, please. There we go. And now you should see my screen, correct?
Yes.
All right, thank you. Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. When it comes down to it, a beautiful presentation like the one that we just saw by our sister Marwa really helps to emphasize the important role that Islam plays in Islamic counseling and Islamic psychology. I was taking so many notes, mashallah, throughout this this presentation, and much of what was said, in fact, all of it, to my recollection, was derived directly from the Islamic tradition. However, for many professionals, Muslim counselors, chaplains, psychologists, psychiatrists, social workers, and general mental health professionals, we have, perhaps throughout the course of our professional life and study, have had to grapple with Islamic, or how Islamic our approach really is. For example, much of those of us here on this panel have letters after our names. Do those letters, for example, signify a professional Islamic or professional Western? And for most cases, then it signifies Western education. How do we let individuals know of, for example, our Islamic learning? As of right now, it's very difficult to convey, and perhaps only done through by word of mouth. And as we have grappled with each of our practices, myself as a chaplain and my fellow panelists here as psychologists and counselors, each of us have had to grapple individually with what that means to be a Muslim doing that, doing whatever we're doing. And so that's why, alhamdulillah, organizations like the Muslim Wellness Foundation are such a breath of fresh air. And for many of us, it's done so alone. And so what I'm going to present here right now is just some reflections on how some Muslims have grappled with this similar issue as well. Now, first, as Muslims, we do have some professional concerns. For example, how can and does Islam inform my practice? In what ways can the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam positively influence my practice and care for my client? Can or should I call what I do Islamic counseling simply because I'm a Muslim? And derived from the well-known text now counseling Muslims, is this these following questions. Is it sufficient to integrate Islamic knowledge or teachings into a pre-existing model of counseling or psychotherapy for the result to be Islamic counseling? Or can Islamic counseling be what happens when a counselor, irrespective of his or her faith, is truly empathic and engages with a Muslim client at a spiritual as well as psychological level? While we have felt alone at times, each of us in our own professional journeys, most likely we've grappled with, are still grappling with, some of these questions. And it's wonderful that we're able to come here tonight to be able to discuss them. But I want to draw attention to the fact that we are not the first ones to grapple with such questions. There are individuals who have come well before us who have addressed similar concerns. If we take a look and consider during the early spread of Islam, Arab Muslims began to increasingly encounter other cultures and approaches to understanding the nature of the world. And many of these individuals were from other cultures, and they brought with them their culture into their newfound faith. And many others who also did not accept Islam involved themselves in debates with Muslim scholars, often using the Greek sciences as a framework for their debates and discussions. However, the early Arabs were not a specifically scientific people as we understand it today. They had their language, their poetry, their love for the memorization of lineage, and of course the Holy Quran. However, they were not especially interested in the philosophical and investigative sciences. Perhaps this is part of the blessing and wisdom why the Quran was revealed to them, because they would receive it so pure and accept it without much question. However, as early proponents of the faith spread out, they encountered other cultures heavily influenced by the Greek philosophical and investigative sciences. And at this time, Muslims were asked questions that were never concerned for them and for the first part of the Islamic century. And so they had to consider whether or not it was appropriate to dive into these foreign sciences that were being brought up into debates. Now here it is worth noting that there's a prominent false dichotomy between science and religion. It's primarily here in the West. But if we take a look at history, we see that each faith has dealt in their own ways with the role of the physical and rational sciences in their understanding of the world within and around them. For the most part, the Western separation of faith and science is something which is formed out of its own historical context, a context that is not representative of how Muslims have historically approached the physical and rational sciences. While controversial, when early Muslims encountered foreign sciences and debates surrounding them, it led to some of the most fascinating discussions within our history concerning the relationship of revelation and reason. And no doubt, there was more than one response to it. And for the most part, Muslims could be divided over three different broad categories across a broad spectrum. those who emphasize the inclusion of these Greek sciences, these foreign sciences, so much so that they held it even as a base framework to understand revelation. And then there are those on the other side who completely abhorred the idea of including any sort of foreign science in the understanding or discussion of issues of faith, the issues even of understanding oneself. And then there are those who are in between. And all of this, and all of these questions, led to some of the greatest advances in Islamic history. In fact, these discussions that came about is what led to the golden age, as it's been said, of Islamic history. And just a bit of reflection upon it. It's been said that one way of understanding Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq, the two Iqras, because when we read Surah Al-Alaq, we actually have the word Iqra said twice. And some of the tafsirs mention that this is because of the two things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks us to read and to learn. So Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq, khalaq al-insana min alaq, Iqra wa rabbuka al-akram alladhi 'allama bil qalam. Recite in the name of your Lord who created man from a clinging substance. Recite again, and your Lord is the most generous, who taught by the pen. And some of the tafsirs mention that one reading is intended for learning the revelation, and the other reading by the pen is by learning human knowledge, learning scientific knowledge. And wallahu ta'ala alam, Allah knows best. But today, rather than the Greek philosophical sciences, or perhaps you could say we're seeing their great-grandchildren, is we're finding Western psychology as being one of the biggest obstacles, or you could say challenges, presented to us right now as Muslims trying to serve the community. How can we serve individuals, and should we adopt the models that are presented before us? Some of you right now, especially those more familiar with psychology, might recognize some of these individuals here. They're Freud and Maslow and Carl Rogers and also Martin Seligman. And you see also Pavlov's dog right there. But there are many other ways as well that have been presented. But how, as Muslims today, should we approach this particular issue? Like in the past, there have been three broad ways of approaching this. There have been those who have emphasized Western psychology as the primary framework of the way that they approach psychology and the inner workings of a human being, covering it in a sense with the veneer of Islam, but the framework is really these Western approaches. The opposite end of that spectrum are those individuals who completely abhor the idea of including any sort of Western psychology or psychological approaches into the care of the Muslim soul. And then the broad in between. Now this has led, and this is related to, three varying approaches that I simply want to gloss over. These varying approaches, which themselves can be seen as laying at different parts of that spectrum, include the adaptation or the adaption of mainstream counseling theory. In my sense, many professionals are in this area. Individuals who seek professional training in Western psychology are oftentimes and this speaks to another issue that we need to provide more opportunities for learning like this about Islamic psychological approaches and bringing people together. But many individuals are actually having to find this along the way on their own while trying to adapt what they're learning in their graduate studies. Another approach which has been professed as another way to provide care for the individual is the tib-based approach, or the approach based upon a tib nabawi, or prophetic medicine. It's a holistic approach which is based also upon pre-modern understandings of health, the body, temperaments, and psychology. And it is another way that individuals seek to provide a way of care which they identify as Islamic. And then a third approach, and the last one I'll be showing here of the varying approaches, is a tasawwuf-based psychotherapeutic model. And this approach is inclusive of the understanding of qalb, and much relates to what Marwa has presented earlier about the basis of the understanding of the qalb, of the aql, and of also the emphasis upon spirituality and its holistic approach and basis in one's life. Now, to be fair, all of these approaches may have varying relationships with Western or mainstream psychological theories. Each individual in their own path in studying psychology has more than likely led themselves or are being led towards one or another or a combination of them. But I merely want to place this in a greater context. That if we're going to ask simply, what is the most Islamic way, then we certainly have to ask ourselves, what makes something Islamic? I consider that there are three primary reasons for this. One is that something is Islamic because of its religious origins. This is that from a theological basis, it can be found directly derived from the Quran or the statements and actions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There's another way that the term Islamic in quotations is used, and that's in relationship to Muslim culture and history. For example, certain types of clothing, certain types of food are considered Islamic, whether that's a correct usage of the term or not, simply because of its relationship with Muslim culture and history. And then the final and most broad is that something coincides with the Islamic values and objectives. And so one could say that certain rights and certain values are Islamic simply because they coincide. No matter who said it, no matter where it's from, no matter its origin, it's Islamic because it agrees with what Islam values and its core objectives. And to provide you with just some examples of these, the Quran itself, an obvious of religious origins. Though, interesting fact though, when you think about it, paper itself is not of Islamic origins, not of Arab origins, but it's literally that recitation of the Quran. And then Islamic dress. And I would even pose the question, this is an obvious drawing here, is the drawing Islamic because it's of Islamic individuals? That's not my main point here, but it certainly brings into question what it is and the reasons why we term something Islamic or not Islamic. And then how about a halal burger? Do we call that Islamic simply because of origins or history? Rather, that's actually because it agrees with Islamic values, though I do recognize that there could be some contestation, there can be some argument to that, inshallah ta'ala. And so how can we know, especially when we're all by, many of us are by ourselves providing this care, and I hear this from many other professionals working in the field. We just want to get together. We want to be able to learn from each other, and that's why I really appreciate this particular gathering and what Sister Camila is putting together here with the Muslim Wellness Foundation. So how can we know? How can we move forward? How can we know that what we're doing is pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that it is of use to individuals, and that it is the way that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam did things. That it's the most it emulates him in the most proper way. And I don't provide you now with that answer, but I do provide this guideline. That Islamic counseling, whatever it is, whatever you want to call it, whatever conclusion you've come up on your own, it is based upon a relationship, an emphasized relationship with revealed knowledge. And as stated in Counseling Muslims, again, it is this relationship that draws many Muslims to Islamic counseling and gives Islamic counseling its significance and credibility. And so with such a focus on self-awareness, as Sister Marwa has reminded us that we all should have for healthy psychology, I ask myself, how much does my practice emulate the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? And I encourage all of you, and how much of a role does revealed knowledge have in our practice? And how can we increase that for the betterment of those we serve? Jazakum Allahu ta'ala khairan.
Thank you, Brother Ibrahim. Again, I'm writing down notes because I think you also hit on some really important points in that the dichotomy between the physical science and faith. And also this idea that even now I think there's a trend towards kind of secularization of societies such that religion and spirituality and faith is seen as almost incompatible, again, with rational minds. How can you be intelligent and logical? How can you be thoughtful and intelligent and believe in the unseen? You know, how can you believe in a creator that you cannot see, and to me, it takes again probably that intelligence of the heart that Marwa referenced to know that with humility that there is a creator that is, you know, bigger and more magnificent than we are. Mm-hmm. I was presenting at a group of middle schoolers. They were in eighth grade, and we were talking about different religions. And so we went through, some were Presbyterian, Protestant, there were a handful of Muslim students. But I would have to say that 50% of these 13-year-olds, I said, who here identifies as atheist and agnostic? And I think half the room raised their hands. And I thought, subhanAllah, like, what has been their understanding of what it means to be a person of faith, and also to value, you know, kind of like you said, the physical sciences. Mm-hmm. So I think in our practice as professionals, it's also knowing clients that may come to therapy, not almost having this ambivalent, this conflict within themselves. You know, if I'm trusting my heart, I'm trusting the Creator, does that mean that I'm ignoring my mind because I've made my mind the king, you know, and the final decision maker? So I think, you know, these are great questions you also pose as, you know, what is Islamic about Islamic counseling? And, you know, how do we, you know, always before we begin our relationship with anyone in a therapeutic setting, really ask, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide, you know, our minds and our hearts, so that we're offering the best, you know, advice possible that's based on, you know, sound knowledge and also compassion. Thank you. You guys are just, you know, providing such excellent knowledge. And, you know, I'm sure that our viewers also appreciate. Someone actually asked me if she could take a screenshot of your presentations. And I said, you know, inshallah, we'll make this information available. So I also want to give Brother Karim an opportunity, you know, to talk about your perspective on Islamic psychology, how you've used it with your clients, and also how you kind of came to really believe that there was, you know, a need to kind of integrate this into the type of therapeutic work that you do. So I'm going to turn it over to you.
Well, thank you very much. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Epic job, Marwa and Ibrahim. I just wanted to say that it's a real hard act to follow, but I'll do my best. And I wanted to discuss a bit more. I think one of the biggest challenges for all of us in this field is psychoeducation itself, and almost kind of breaking through the taboo with our community around why this is a beneficial and helpful field. I mean, I always tell Muslims we study more and more about less and less. You know, we have about three main tracks that we all go into, generally engineering, medicine, and something else in tech. So we're learning more and more about less and less, and meanwhile we're losing the depth of understanding the social and human sciences, which is something that, as we learned today, in our history has been a big part of our civilization. So I just wanted to do a quick kind of reflection on one of the things that I share with the community, and maybe this could be helpful for everyone listening as well as our practitioners, is that I often sometimes say that the Prophet Muhammad himself was a psychologist. And the reason why I say that is because if you look at the phases of his mission, they are in many ways parallel or symbolic, if you will, of the counseling or therapeutic treatment process. So if I could just share here. Let me know if it's on. Can we see that? Yes or no? I can't hear.
No, I saw it for a second, and then it cut out.
Okay, how about now?
I still don't see it.
Okay, one moment. Sorry about that. Okay, how about now, Ibrahim? Can you see that?
Yep, you got it.
Okay, great. So just a few slides here to kind of guide us. First off, we all are familiar with this taboo, and I think that it is also connected to, let's say, three points that I want to share here. The first one is Muslim cultures, as we know, are what anthropology would call shame-based culture. We have a very strong emphasis on external standards of judgment and evaluation. In other words, you know, what will people say? What will people think? We need to have a certain social status or reputation to uphold. And, you know, going to a therapist, going to a counselor kind of takes away from that sense of dignity and honor that many Muslim families work very hard to maintain and keep. The second reason I believe that we have this taboo towards psychology as a community is, of course, the idea that psychology is rooted in Western paradigms, as Brother Ibrahim also shared with us, and more importantly, this idea that psychology is a new science or field that emerged in the early 1900s, and of course, the first thing anyone says to me when I say I'm a psychologist, they say, oh, Sigmund Freud, or can you read my mind? And I say, no, I can't read your mind, but I can interpret your behaviors and get a good sense of what your mind's thinking. But this idea of psychology is, you know, comes from Sigmund Freud, and there's all these, you know, weird complexes that many Muslims kind of dismiss without understanding what it's all about. I, of course, try to bring the education around the history of Islamic sciences and how we do have a concept of ilm al-nafs, or the science of the self. And, of course, ulum al-ihsan and tasawwuf are wonderful frameworks that, you know, our scholars and masters throughout our history have provided for human development, spiritual and mental purification, as well as growth. So this is something that I feel like many Muslims, we don't even know our history. And this is part of the process of psychoeducation and deconstructing the taboo. The last point that I find pretty common is this idea that, hey, Islam's a way of life. There's no need for counseling or therapy. We've got everything we need in Islam. And, you know, I call this the Islam is all we need syndrome. And this idea is basically flawed because, again, if we know our history, we recognize that, you know, all of the sciences that the Muslim civilization excelled in, often they were already grounded in other cultures and other civilizations. And what we did as Muslims is we took that in and then re-expressed it through the lens of Tawheed. So this is not something that was uncommon in our history to begin with. The other aspect of that is when it comes to any other science or any other need or support that the human being seeks, whether it's medical support or engineering support, we never say Islam is enough. Right? If I have something, an ailment in my body, we will go to a doctor. No one's going to say, well, just pray, brother, and inshallah, your cancer will go away. We always supplement prayer with actual medical diagnosis and treatment. If we need to build a bridge, we do get civil planners and engineers to construct it. We don't get the local imam to try to build a bridge for us. So this idea of, you know, Islam is the only thing that we need, I think can also be detrimental if it's not balanced and, of course, rooted with reason as well. So often I'll have clients who even come to me, they'll say, you know, brother, I went to several imams before and, you know, I had all these issues, and they would say things like, just pray more, or they would quote a hadith or Quran and then expect that that's supposed to, you know, change my life. And this isn't to take away, of course, from the roles of our imams and the roles of religion and prayer, etc. But I think that we need to kind of recalibrate this understanding, because an imam in Arabic just means a leader. It just means somebody that you follow. So there's imams in every field, in every science, in every subject, if you will. So one example of this that I'd like to kind of help us understand in application is this idea of, we know that you have to be good to your wives. You know, often the Prophet ﷺ is quoted, and, you know, I'm the best to the best of you are those who are best to your wives, and I'm the best to my wives. Okay, wonderful. So if my wife, for example, or even husband, let's just take it as a partner in a marriage, they are giving there's a lot of aggression and criticism and maybe even violence, and you go to an imam and they just say, hey, you should be good to your wife because it's following the Prophet. That's great, but at the same time, how do I actually apply this in practice? And what if I go home and I say the hadith, or I tell my wife or husband that this is how it's got to be, you got to follow the sunnah, but it's just not working. What do you do next? And this is where I think the power of counseling and therapy and these professional health fields really come into play, because there's always so much more to the individual story than simply just sharing a piece of advice or a quote. Oftentimes there are deeper reasons behind why this individual has certain character traits, whether it be trauma or negative experiences in the past, other types of pain that were caused within the relationship itself. So these are things that oftentimes we overlook in light of Islam is all we need syndrome. The next thing I'd like to share here is this idea of the beautiful analogy that we could extract from the prophetic phases in his mission, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and what we might call the psychology process. And so quickly here, the first thing that we know about the prophetic mission is that the Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, by his nature, he was al-amin, and he was a seeker of light. And especially in the dark times of his society, he used to often go and reflect and ask himself questions about how things can change and why things are so dark. And oftentimes the client will reach out to a professional helper when they begin to recognize they really need help and that they're in dark times in their life. And so there's this type of reflection as well as acceptance around being humble and recognizing that sometimes you need support to get through the challenges that you face. The second phase that you find in the prophetic mission is that the Prophet ﷺ first started to identify incorrect beliefs and false beliefs. This was happening before he became a prophet, as well as at the beginning of becoming a prophet. We know that the majority of wahi that came down, it was all about iman and aqidah and constructing a proper belief system. And similarly, in the psychology process, we begin with the counseling or therapy as learning the personal story of the client and helping the client gain self-awareness and realize their personal issues. In other words, coming to terms with what kind of beliefs have been held and constructed over the years and how that's influencing their moods and behaviors. Another concept in the field is CBT or cognitive behavioral therapy. The next phase that we find with the Prophet ﷺ is this idea of identifying now the social ills and the individual diseases that are a result of the incorrect beliefs. And of course challenging the power structure itself, the society itself, because the society is often the first system which allows these beliefs and social diseases to continue by practicing them blindly through tradition. As we know, the Quran ridicules this approach of we do what our forefathers do. And this is even something that Muslims do today. They inherit their Muslim traditions or certain understandings and they say, I'm not going to challenge that because that's what my forefathers did and we're going to follow what our forefathers did, even if they're Muslim and even if they're wrong. So this is also something that I've recognized in working with the Muslim community. It even applies to us. And in the psychology process, we have to recognize these behaviors and challenge our own stories and challenge our own traditions and cultures, even if they are Muslim, because it's not enough to say, well, if my parents are Muslim, I just do what they say. We still need to have a sincere introspective process. And the last two points here is this idea that the Prophet ﷺ, during his da'wah, would address individuals and tribes based on their backgrounds. So this kind of reflects this idea of every client has a unique story and case-by-case action plan and treatments are tailored for the specific needs of the person or the couple or the family. And last point that I think is very profound is one of the powers of religion in general is this idea of having ultimate accountability before the divine, before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we as therapists and counselors, we provide a wonderful safe space for people to hold themselves accountable through our feedback and our professional observations. And the consistency itself allows the self to go through accountability. Lastly, the Prophet ﷺ used to check up on his community. He used to ask about people when they weren't around and make sure that information was shared. And so as helpers, we also are checking in with these individuals and families that we're trying to work with and hope that they improve their lives weekly or monthly, etc. And oftentimes we keep checking in with our clients to ensure this success. So my last point here that I'd like to share is I like to see Islamic psychology as Islam itself as is a path to the divine. And this, of course, includes, you know, beliefs, character, worship, and social transactions, what we might call the universals. So, you know, all three of us here, and probably most of the people listening, they are Muslim, and we share a lot of universals. Like, we have basic tenets that we all agree to and rituals that we practice. However, I like to see Islamic psychology as the individual journey on that path to the divine. And so everyone is different, and we're going to face unique challenges provided who we are and our character and our personal context. And this is more about the particulars. And this is why I don't believe we all need to be the same or act the same as Muslims. We already share the universals, and that gives us the common ground. But in the end of the day, we all have to find our individual purpose and meaning and how to serve Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And sometimes this is overlooked. Because we believe we all have to, you know, feel and act a certain way because we all share the same Islamic tradition. And that's my little slideshow. I hope that was clear, inshallah.
Well, yes, very clear, alhamdulillah. One thing I noted, and you know, I'll give you guys some time because I'm sure you have questions of one another. There's also some questions that have been submitted about this idea of learning more and more about less and less. and so for that was the first thing I noted. but you know, one thing that I really consider, especially given the level of discrimination and misunderstanding that many in the community are experiencing right now, I actually think that this is kind of an area in which we have to pay more attention. So thinking about, you know, the counseling needs of the community, the emotional well-being of the community, and I think that there's unfortunately been kind of perpetuated this idea that we have to appear to be stoic and resilient and kind of just unaffected by the level of, you know, just anti-Muslim bigotry, Islamophobia, so that seeking counseling in some ways, I don't know, provides ammunition to those who would attack the community to say that, you know, see, they're not doing well, you know, you know, there's instances of different types of abuses in the community, and that's somehow attributed to Islam. So for those who are either students or thinking about psychology, or perhaps wondering whether or not this is a viable area to kind of explore in terms of spiritual counseling, I was wondering what would each of you say to, you know, say a junior, you know, in college who may have been encouraged to go kind of the engineering or the medical route, but really wants to explore Islamic psychology or psychotherapy. What would you say to them in terms of being able to pursue that as a viable career choice? And anyone can jump in on that one.
Well, bismillah. I think another way to answer that question is, I mean, nowadays getting a degree doesn't necessarily mean you're going to be successful, right? It really also comes down to the hard work, the intention, and how you make the most of what you studied. That's kind of a general tip. Now, for people that are interested in going into the field of social sciences and humanities, absolutely. I think that it's a huge lack in our ummah, or at least in our Muslim community in the West. It's just so uncommon. And what's so fascinating to me is that we are people, and we don't have enough experts who understand people themselves. Right? Mm. And we say Islam is a religion for all humanity in all times and all places. But then we lack when it comes to actually understanding what humankind is all about in a deeper sense. Right? So I thought that I think that I encourage it. I think it's a need that we have. Will it be received by some families? Not all the time. But in the end of the day, we all have to remember we are here to serve Allah. And our parents, we honor them, but at the same time, we have to recognize that we are here to serve Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And, you know, I know some individuals that they wanted to go into other fields and sciences, but their parents were very strict about them studying what they wanted them to study. And that's a struggle for some people, because it's like, on the one hand, I want to do what I feel I'm created for, and on the other hand, my parents say they're going to have a heart attack if I don't become a doctor. So it's like, what do you do with that, you know? But I think it's a wonderful opportunity for Muslims to step up.
Thank you. And I actually have, there are two questions, two related questions. The first is, what are some recommended books or resources for anyone seeking additional information on Islamic psychology for future therapists?
Well, I think we could maybe share a list, and we can put that on the Google Hangout wall. I can think of one off the top of my head I just read, actually, called Psychology from an Islamic Perspective. I think it was actually published in Saudi Arabia. But so that's kind of, I like that because it is very well structured, but at the same time, what I feel is lacking is there is no concept or integration of tasawwuf. I found that very interesting. But then again, you know, there's different approaches to the religion, I guess. So, but there's still a lot of benefit that could be taken from that book.
Yeah, actually, just to, oh, hold on. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, so just to actually jump on to that, I agree with you, Karim, concerning that the lack of integration. It's so much so on a very much theoretical level and theoretical reflections, and much of the literature is more of a Islamic modification to pre-existing models. Like there's the Islamic modification of person-centered therapy, of mindfulness, of CBT, these type of, you know, basically it relates to the first varying approach that I mentioned there. There are two books that I definitely would recommend for our member who is joining us and asked a question. The first is an obvious one, and I mentioned it earlier. I have it right here, Counseling Muslims, which came out just a few years ago. Which provides the, I'll just hold it there for a second, which provides the best overview of the state of Islamic counseling. And actually, from what I understand, one of the next talks by Muslim Wellness Foundation is going to include one of the editors of this collected edition. And it is excellent. It is every Muslim counselor, chaplain, therapist, I believe, should have this. And for what Karim was mentioning concerning more of the integration, the closest book I've ever come across is actually this one in regards to integration, which is called Man and the Universe, and it's written by Mustafa al-Badawi. Literally, these books are so important that I didn't want to attend this lecture without having them next to me. So this one right here is Mustafa al-Badawi. He's actually a clinical psychologist, and he's also a man well trained in the traditional sciences, including tasawwuf, spirituality. And what he does here is he basically provides the framework. So he doesn't actually expand to this is what Islamic psychology looks like. He says this is what Islamic psychology should consider and should have. And he does it through a presentation of actually how Muslims have classically and traditionally understand the world within and around us. And so it's theoretical, and it's also a beautiful spiritual book also in that regard as well, but it's both, it's definitely good for those interested in the integration of Islamic traditional thought into what they might already know or are learning of psychology.
Right.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
Marwa, I actually had, there's another question that one of the viewers posed, and I thought maybe you know, you can kind of take this this question. Just give me one second.
Before we go to that question, can I just add, Malik Bedri is another author that came to mind who has been writing about Islam and psychology since the 70s, and he has a couple of books. I think, I don't remember the name, Contemplative Psychology, but Malik Bedri.
Yeah, Contemplation in Islam, I think.
Yeah, and he has another book, too, called The Problem with Western Psychology, which is also talks about framework and approach as well, which is a good read for anybody planning to go into the field.
Mm-hmm.
And I did want to add to that list Robert Fraser as well. You know, a lot of what I used for this presentation had to do with was from his book, The Heart, Self, and Soul. And you know, Robert Fraser, he taught psychology for over 30 years, but he also studied Sufism for the last two decades. So he has a good ground of knowledge in both, and the integration is really the way he integrates the concept is really well thought out in his book.
Okay, those are I just posted all of those, and we can also inshallah send out kind of a complete book list. So I know there's also really good articles that people may want to have access to. And so we can, inshallah, make sure people have that information. So there's the question that was posed was how important do you think it is for people to take into account the popular culture and media influences we deal with daily when we go about understanding the self, the heart, the mind, and now individual psychology through the lens of Islam? So thinking about kind of pop culture, media influences, and how we come to an understanding of self, heart, and mind through the lens of Islamic psychology.
I think it's really important to be aware of what popular culture says about psychology in general, and a lot of the times, just even teaching psychology generally, aside from Islamic psychology, you have to always make the distinction between what people know in terms of popular psychology and what actually is taught in what actually psychology is. So even when it comes to just teaching psychology generally, there's a lot of times a distinction between what people understand psychology to be through the media. And also there is, like I said, we were talking about, this understanding of the heart being the king, right? This is something that goes against a popular understanding of psychology, right? That would be, that is portrayed in our media, in our culture. There is an emphasis on this intelligence to be the king, to be the lead force. We idolize intelligence. And it was not long ago that this research went into understanding what emotional intelligence is, right? Mm-hmm. That they started making a distinction between, IQ and EQ, the intelligent quotient and the emotional intelligence quotient, right? And that they even saw a correlation between emotional intelligence and the success of individuals, in various settings, and how emotional intelligence can even be a stronger portraying, can be a stronger factor in determining success. So, a lot of times there's going to be there's going to be a learning curve, just like I said, just teaching psychology generally, you always have to make distinctions. There's so many concepts that we understand, like even the concept of, being an extrovert versus introvert. We understand that completely differently than what it actually is according to psychology, And you see a wealth of articles being written on, if you're an extrovert, then you're like this, and if you're an introvert, you're like this. And people believe it, and people take it as, as to be completely true. And there's actually, a different lens in which psychology views extroversion and introversion qualities. So I think it's not believing everything you see in the media, it's with anything else, and it's understanding that, there are going to be, this concept of the heart being the king is just going to be a strange dialogue to have for a lot of people, in just generally, So, and it's being okay, and it's, it's being okay with that. It's being okay with, this is going to sound strange a little bit, but there's truth to this, and let's see what it has to say,
So, unfortunately, we're just 3 minutes shy of, our end time. So I wanted to just really briefly, maybe like 30 seconds, if there was one takeaway message you would want the viewers to understand about Islamic psychology, or just kind of any parting messages that you would all, like to share, please do so.
There's many questions that that have been raised actually from this discussion, but if there is a takeaway message, something to take, is that psychology and the care of others begins with oneself and the care of oneself. And if we take a look and we consider what nasiha is, oftentimes it's translated as advice. You know, adino nasiha, as the Prophet said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it's often translated as advice, but it's actually more than that. It's to have also a sincere concern for other people. And we've been speaking so much about the conception and the conceptualizing of Islamic psychology, but it's also centered in the heart of the practitioner. And one thing that I've certainly taken from whatever time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has willed for me so far to be of service is care for yourself and care for others. That one cannot do one without the other. So that would be my takeaway message, inshallah.
Exactly. Really important. I would say, you know, two main points. One is, you know, is to own our faith and what it has to offer to psychology, you know, and you know, there is a need, right? And this need is reflected in how much research effort is being put into understanding what Eastern traditions and philosophies and religions have to offer to psychology, because they're missing something, you know. And my first point is that, you know, because there's a lot of hesitance when it comes to incorporating religion, you know, and into therapy. There's that hesitance, you know. And I think it's really important to own what our deen has to offer and to really, you know, divulge with confidence into what it has to offer. And number two, I would say that with anything that we're seeking knowledge of, so, you know, whether we're seeking knowledge about any aspect of the creation, it's important to understand that Allah is the destination, right? So when it comes to seeking ourselves, it's very crucial that we do not make ourselves the destination, right? And this is what leads, because this is what differentiates Islamic psychology from any other approach, is that, you know, there are many who go into psychoanalysis for years, but the goal is themselves, right? To seek, you know, the destination is me, right? And in Islamic perspective says, you know, you are not the destination, and making ourselves the destination or knowledge the destination leads to a level of distress on its own. So a lot of times we'll go on this path of self, you know, we want to understand ourselves and we want to improve and we want, you know, but because we didn't realize the true destination, you know, it led to a level of self-obsession. It led to understanding ourselves in a way that wasn't healthy and didn't promote, you know, a level of peace and stability in our lives. And we know that narcissism, you know, we hear this all the time, narcissism is on the rise because of this age of me, myself, and I. So it's important, you know, and Imam Ghazali says, "Man arafa nafsahu arafa rabbahu," whoever knows himself knows his Lord. And this is really important, an important reminder that when we seek the self-knowledge, you know, and we seek the understanding of the self, which is psychology, it's to know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the destination.
I would just like to add one verse that I feel is central to my approach and work with a lot of my clients is Bismillah ar-Rahim, لَقَدْ خَلَقَنَا الْإِنسَانَ وَنَعْلَمُ مَا تُوَسْوِسُ بِهِ نَفْسُهُ وَنَحْنُ أَقْرَبُ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ حَبْلِ الْوَرِيدِ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the self, He knows what the self whispers to Himself, and God is closer to your jugular vein. And I think that verse is just so profound because it really gives us guidance around this concept of sincerity. In other words, you can't play games with God. You can't keep, you know, denying what's going on for you inside and playing, you know, having an alternative agenda with your friends or family or partner or parents. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees right through you. You're totally transparent. And I think this type of vulnerability really helps the individual be sincere and, of course, more aware of his knowledge of the self, so kind of building off of what Sister Marwa just shared. And I think the take-home for anybody listening is work on ikhlas, being sincere, and no matter what you do, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you success, whether it's in psychology or engineering or being a friend or a partner or a child. So that's what I have to say.
Well, I want to take the time to thank all of the panelists sincerely and deeply from my heart. I think this is, you know, very inspiring for me as the professional, but also I think for many of the people listening, that we do come to an understanding of the type of work that we do through our commitment to the faith and to actually living those principles. So when people say Islam is a way of life, I say absolutely. So this should be reflected regardless of the work that you do. So whether or not you are, you know, an engineer or you drive a bus or you're a nurse, the principles of Islam that really stress compassion and empathy and understanding of one another should really shine through the work that we do. So inshallah, I hope that those who are listening, there are a few other questions, and I'll make sure that I send those off to the panelists, and perhaps we can post them later via social media and on this Google Plus page. You know, just additional questions some people had. But, you know, I thank you for your time and for your expertise and for your sincerity in being able to share with our viewers the information really important around Islamic psychology. And, you know, I would just kind of emphasize one of the points that Sister Marwa made, is that we should, during a time where a lot of kind of what we believe as Muslims and how we live is being vilified kind of generally in the mainstream society, that really it is up to us to kind of fully embrace and take some degree of comfort in that, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided us with so much. You know, I feel like we haven't really even begun to mine all of the richness that we have been, you know, really blessed with through our tradition and through the Holy Quran. So for those who are interested in psychology, do know that the exploration of the mind and the heart is not incompatible with being Muslim. That there's, you know, we have an example of our beloved prophet, and I think Brother Karim did an excellent job of, you know, showing side by side the prophetic journey and also the therapeutic process, so that if we can begin to shift our hearts to understanding that the knowledge of self and then, you know, ultimately the knowledge of the Creator is something that we do want to strive to attain. For those who would like to get in contact with the panelists, I've posted Brother Karim's and Sister Marwa's email addresses. Brother Ibrahim, you'll give me the email address where people can reach out to you if they have additional questions. Or you can just, yeah.
Of course, not a problem. Inshallah.
So the last thing I would like to kind of a preview of another event that's coming up for Muslim Wellness Foundation, referenced by Brother Ibrahim, is a day-long symposium that will be held here in Philadelphia at the University of Pennsylvania, and it is called Faith, Identity, and Well-Being, Exploring the Psychology of Black Muslims. And this topic was really born out of, you know, looking at the intersection of the rise in anti-Muslim bigotry, but also kind of increased attention nationally on the Black Lives Matter movement and police brutality, so that, you know, there's an understanding that Black Muslims specifically are impacted and face discrimination and kind of microaggressions as a result of religious discrimination as well as racial profiling. So I wanted to share that information. Okay, so that is Friday, June 19th, 8:30 to 5:30 p.m. at the University of Pennsylvania. And Friday, June 19th is actually a pretty significant day in that it's the 150th anniversary of Juneteenth, which is the oldest nationally known commemoration or celebration of the ending of American slavery. It is also the first Jummah of Ramadan. So, you know, this day of reflection on both kind of our spiritual purification process, but also the ending of slavery in the United States, which in fact actually came 2.5 years after the Emancipation Proclamation, so that there were still those who were enslaved 2 years after that declaration who did not know that they had been emancipated. So this is a practice that was a celebration that was begun in Texas, I believe. So we wanted to acknowledge kind of both that history of, you know, spiritual purification as well as freedom from oppression. And so how we think about these two identities and also spiritual and cultural resilience of the community. So I would encourage those who are in the area who can travel. I know it's Ramadan, it's hard, but we felt really strongly that this was an important date for us to have this conversation. So again, the contact information for our panelists will be made available, as well as the highlights of their presentation. And I thank everyone who's been listening, who have questions, who engaged, and also, again, thank the panelists for doing such a wonderful, wonderful job. I'm so happy. I can't wait to kind of go back. I'm sure there were so many things that I missed that I want to take notes about. So, alhamdulillah, thank you so much for participating and for offering your time. And before we close, I would ask that, Brother Ibrahim, if you could close us with dua as well.
Of course. And Sister Camila, I first thank you for organizing all of this. And may Allah bless you and bless all those who helped to make this possible. Bismillah wa alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salam wa rasulillah. O Allah, may you bless all of us in our exiting now, and be with us on our further journey in understanding ourselves and understanding how best to act in the way that both that emulates the best way your beloved, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. O Allah, may you bless all those who have been with us, those who hear this later, and all of us here who have been a part of this. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Wal asr. Innal insana lafi khusr. Illa alladhina amanu wa amilu salihat. وتواصل بالحق وتواصل بالصبر والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
Assalamu alaikum to all of those who are listening. Have a good night and have a wonderful day tomorrow, inshallah.
JazakAllah khair. Assalamu alaikum. JazakAllah khair.